guys, I'm Dr. Janki Shah and I'm back with a very important topic for final BDS. And it is almost a sure shot question that will be asked to you. How will you do infection control in a dental clinic? So how does infection get transmitted in a clinic? It can be through direct contact with blood, oral fluids or other secretions. Through indirect contact with contaminated instruments, operatory equipment or environmental surfaces, and contact with airborne contaminants present in the airborne contaminants present in either droplet splatter or aerosols of oral and respiratory fluids. So there are OSHA regulations, that is Occupational Safety and Health Act regulations, which have been laid down. The first one is to provide hepatitis B immunization, universal precautions, engineering controls to reduce the production of contaminated splatter, mists and aerosols, work practice control precautions, washing hands after removing gloves, safe handling of needles and sharps, use disposable items, dispose them in a hard wall leak-proof biohazard label container. Prohibit eating, drinking and handling of instruments. Blood and contaminated specimens to be transported or stored into suitable leak-proof containers. Use necessary personal protective equipment like gloves, gowns, etc. Housekeeping requirements. Reusable contaminated sharp instruments to be transferred in a hard wall container to clean up area. And laundering of protective garments. But if a question is asked to you, how will you do infection control in a clinic? This is what I suggest. These six headings, which will cover everything. So let's start with the first thing, that is medical history. A thorough history should be taken at the first visit and update at subsequent visits. That is, if the patient comes to you after 1 year, again you need to ask him if there has been anything which has been done during that 1 year which requires particular attention. With the history of corona going on, travel history of the patient is important. The type of fever, the duration and the diagnosis of the fever, if the patient can tell you, will alert you to pre-medicate or refer the patient for special medical or dental care. It warns us of the infectious disease status, that is to identify high-risk patients. Find out about any previous hospitalization or the reason for that hospitalization. Drugs, if the patient has been taking regularly or during before few months, and the reason for taking that drugs. Recommend to treat all patients as potentially infectious and routinely use universal precautions in all patients. So, medical history is the first step for infection control. Various universal precautions include vaccines, barrier techniques, sterilization and disinfection, and waste disposal. So, we'll be taking each in detail. The various barrier techniques which we have are medical gloves, they can be latex or vinyl, sterile gloves for surgical procedures, washing hands before and after removing gloves. Washing of gloves may cause wicking, therefore they should not be reused. Disinfecting agents, oils, heat treatments such as autoclave may also cause deterioration of gloves. The chin length plastic face shields and surgical masks should be changed between patients or during patient if it becomes wet. Aluminium foil, which is wrapped around chair, tray, light handle, etc., to be changed after every patient. And protective eyewear. So the personal protection again, gloves, hand washing, masks, protective eyewear, protective clothing, immunization and protection against needle stick injuries. So this is a diagram which you can remember. Okay, the thing is the glove permeability, there are natural porosities in the latex which are 100 times greater than the viral capsid diameters, and therefore it's very important that you wash your hands before and after every patient's, that is before wearing the gloves and after removing the gloves. And many a times there are manufacturing defects too in the gloves. Gloves do not protect you against needle stick injuries, and that is the greatest cause of bloodborne occupational viral infections. Personal meaning all the people who are working inside the clinic with you. So it's very important that not only should you be educated and trained, the people who are working in the clinic, that is the personnel, should also be educated and trained, including the description of the exposure risks, the prevention strategies, the infection control policies and procedures, work-related illnesses and injuries, including personal exposure potential and review of work restrictions for the exposure or infection. So we know that there is a vaccine for hepatitis B, which should be taken at 0, 1 and 6 months, and booster dose 5 to 7 years according to the manufacturer's instructions. How can you prevent exposure, and in case the exposure occurs, what to do? So after occupational, you have to avoid occupational exposures to blood. Exposures include percutaneous injury through contact with potentially infectious blood tissues or other body fluids and mucous membranes of the eye, nose, mouth or non-intact skin. So wear proper personal protective equipment. Like I told you, hands should be washed before and after with the soap in the correct way. And a mouth mask should be used, which should cover your mouth and nose, able to filter particles of 3 to 5 μm and to be replaced with each new patient every hour. In case the mask becomes moist, then the resistance to airflow through mask increases, and therefore if it becomes wet, you need to change the mask. The mask can be rigid pre-contoured or pre-formed cups, or they can be soft pleated rectangular masks. They can be paper masks, they can be theater type masks and dome masks. Protective eyewear, goggles, glass with or without shield or a face shield. The face shield should be chin length, provide top protection, to be curved to provide side protection. Mask reduces the inhalation of aerosols and dust particles. The protective clothing should be fluid resistant, may be reusable or disposable, high neck, long sleeve, knee length. Should be removed when leaving the clinical area, should be sent to a different laundry and not to be taken home. Prevention of needle stick injuries can be done by use of a needle guard, that is basically guide the needle into the sheath or the bayonet technique and use needle cutters before disposal. Needles, blades, wires or are potentially infective, and therefore used needle should never be recapped or otherwise manipulated using both hands. One-handed scoop technique or mechanical device designed for holding the needle sheet to be employed. The sharp should be disposed in a puncture-resistant container. Bending and breaking the needles before disposal involves unnecessary manipulation and should not be done. After an exposure injury, wound should be washed thoroughly under running water and squeezed to encourage bleeding. The site of the injury should be wiped with the alcohol and then covered with a waterproof dressing. So, vaccination. Post-exposure hepatitis B of an unvaccinated patient. The aerosols. So, when you use a aerator or a scaler, there's something known as aerosols which are liberated in the air. It contains saliva, nasopharyngeal secretions, plaque, blood, tooth components, abrasives, are used in polishing. The sources are instruments, water lines, plaque, hand pieces, ultrasonic scalers, air polishers, air abrasion units, and The diseases they are known to spread are pneumonia, tuberculosis, influenza, SARS, and now corona. So what are aerosols? They are particles which are lesser than 50 μm in the diameter, and the particles stay airborne for an extended period of time before they settle on the environmental surfaces or enter the respiratory tract. They have the potential to penetrate and lodge in smaller passages of lungs and carry the greatest potential for transmitting the infection. So how can you reduce the aerosol production and reduce airborne contamination? By use of masks, gloves, eyewear, use of a pre-procedural mouth rinse by the patient. It can be either chlorhexidine or Listerine for 1 minute, using a rubber dam, using a HEPA filter, UV chambers in the ventilation system, and using high volume evacuator, that is suction machines. Before sterilizations, instruments should be cleaned with detergents or a mechanical device, and then the sterilization can be done by autoclave, chemical sterilization, dry heat ovens, ethylene oxide gas, boiling water, ionizing radiation. You know how sterilization is done. Then storage of the sterilized instruments. Instruments should be wrapped or bagged before the sterilization. Suitable wrap materials such as muslin, clear pouches or paper should be used. Pins, staples or paper clips should not be used, as they make holes and permit the entry of microorganisms. Cleaning and disinfecting of dental unit and environmental surfaces should be done by a towel, using an appropriate cleaning agent, and disinfected with a suitable germicide. Phenols, iodophores and chlorine containing compounds can be used. And the most cheapest one which can be used is sodium hypochlorite or household bleach. The surface asepsis can be carried out by clear plastic wraps or plastic bag papers or aluminium foil, which are covered on headrests, handpieces, shafts and hoses, instrument tables, countertops, handles, switches and controls, and need to be changed after every patient. Pre-cleaning should be done by the dental staff. The dental staff who is pre-cleaning should use reusable heavy rubber work gloves. Contaminated instruments should be put in an ultrasonic cleanser along with detergent iodophore solution for 5 minutes. Cleaning agents which can be used as soap and water and detergents, and disinfectant, that is spray disinfectant on pre-clean surface and let it be moist for 10 minutes. Various disinfectants used in dentistry are sodium hypochlorite, chlorine dioxide, iodophores, phenols, alcohols, glutaraldehyde, benzalkonium chloride, and hydrogen peroxide. You need to autoclave the handpieces as per the manufacturer's instructions. Surface disinfection by wiping with a surface disinfectant is not acceptable. Anti-retraction valves should be filled in the dental unit water lines to prevent fluid aspiration and to reduce risk of cross-infection. High-speed handpieces should be run to discharge water and air for minimum 20 to 30 seconds after use on each patient so that the retraction is not there. High-velocity evacuation to be used to minimize the spread of spray, splatter, and aerosols generated during the discharge procedures. Sterile salines or sterile water to be used as coolant during the surgical procedures. Items like handles, dental unit attachments of air water syringes should be covered with impervious barriers, which need to be changed after each use or cleaned with a chemical germicide. Water lines to all instruments should be flushed after each patient and at the beginning of today. And the last is waste disposal, which we'll be covering in the next lecture.